1945, Article 7 of the UN Charter created the International Court of Justice, or the ICJ. Article 1 of the Charter states, "To bring about by peaceful means, and in conformity with the principles of justice and international law, adjustment or settlement of international disputes or situations which might lead to a breach of the peace." This is the ICJ.
The United Nations Security Council and the United Nations General Assembly select 15 judges on 9-year terms in the ICJ, with both of those bodies voting separately. A clear majority from both must occur for a judge to be elected. Currently, Judge Peter Tomko of Slovakia is the president of the ICJ. Every 3 years, 5 new judges get elected. To keep things fair and just, no 2 judges are allowed to be from the same country.
The International Court of Justice was the successor to the Permanent Court of International Justice. Often called the World Court, it was a part of the League of Nations. Due to the tumultuous times leading up to World War II, the World Court was used less frequently, finally ceasing to exist and being replaced by the International Court of Justice.
With its legal presiding taking place at the Peace Palace, found in The Hague, Netherlands, the ICJ is the center of international law. The Peace Palace is the home to many facets of international law, including the Permanent Court of Arbitration and the Peace Palace Library, among many others. Opened in 1913, it has been the home of the United Nations primary judicial body since 1946, and the only principal organ of the UN not located in New York.
Throughout its 67 years, the ICJ has heard a lot of cases involving international judiciary issues. These cases vary in many different disputes. Some of them make you wonder, how is this court even considered the judicial medium of the United Nations? You know, they even heard a case on road construction taking place in Costa Rica and Nicaragua. While they're hearing that, they'll also hear a case involving the spraying of herbicides in Ecuador and Colombia. Both are vastly different and yet at the same time very similar. They each employ a similar procedure to getting heard by the court in the first place. They proved very simply that there has been a disturbance in the international community.
The ICJ case of Nicaragua versus the United States I find to be particularly compelling. In 1984, Nicaragua submitted a case to the ICJ charging the U.S. with violating treaty obligations due to their military operations in and against Nicaragua. During the Nicaraguan Revolution in 1979, a socialist, pro-communist government overthrew the U.S.-backed Somoza dynasty. The U.S. helped fund Contra rebels in order to overthrow this new government, which Nicaragua took issue with. The U.S. argued to the ICJ that their actions in aiding the Contras were only to protect the national security of El Salvador. The judges overwhelmingly ruled in favor of Nicaragua, despite finding some evidence that there was arms flow between Nicaragua and El Salvador. The evidence was not proportionate to the U.S. military response. A key ruling by the ICJ in this case was the ruling that Contras were not an organ of the U.S. government. Despite receiving funding from the U.S., they were not completely dependent on them. Thus, many of the charges against the Contras, including human rights violations, were not charged to the U.S. The U.S.'s main dispute with the case is that they did not feel the ICJ had proper jurisdiction. The ICJ claimed they did on the basis of either Article 36 or on the basis of the 1956 Treaty of Friendship, Commerce, and Navigation between the two states. The U.S. was thus subject to the court's rule. Dissatisfied with the ICJ ruling, the U.S. was absent at the final ruling. The ICJ forced the U.S. to stop their actions and pay reparations to Nicaragua, which it never did.
Another interesting contentious case is Australia v. Japan. This case examines Japan's part in the whaling pandemic. Using the International Convention for the Regulation of Whaling, or ICRW, Australia is suing Japan to put an end to whaling once and for all. 15 countries, including Japan and Australia, signed the ICRW in 1946. Being that this convention is international, the ICJ has its jurisdiction. However, there is a loophole in the ICRW that makes this case tricky. It allows for the rules of whaling to be changed by a government if they feel it's necessary. Japan claims that their whaling is for scientific research, and if proven to be true, this can change the opinion of the entire case. Currently, no decision has been made on this case. In late 2012, New Zealand, under Article 63 of the ICJ statute, has been granted the right to intervene in this case.
Another extremely interesting ICJ court case was the 2004 case between Romania and Ukraine, which dealt with maritime delimitation in the Black Sea. All the way back in 1997, Ukraine and Romania reached two legal agreements, which included an agreement to delimitate the continental shelf and the exclusive economic zones of the two states in the Black Sea. The agreement also stated that could the delimitation of the Black Sea not be completed through negotiations, that the ICJ could handle the case. On September 16, 2004, the Romanian side brought a case to the court following 24 unsuccessful rounds of bilateral negotiations. A major sticking point of this conflict was Snake Island, a Ukrainian territory whose status as an island was vital in this case. If Snake Island was considered an island, then the continental shelf surrounding it would be Ukrainian water. If it was ruled that Snake Island was merely a rock, then the maritime boundary between the states would not have had to take Snake Island into consideration. The court concluded that the presence of Snake Island did not call for an adjustment of the provisional equidistance line. The ICJ ended up finding a middle ground between the two states, and they decided on a boundary they felt was fair and just.
Why is it when we Google positive aspects of the ICJ, nothing comes up? However, when you type in criticisms of the ICJ, pages and pages of articles appear right before your eyes. Is it possible that the ICJ has actually done more harm than good? And if that's the case, who's to blame? However, a lot of international courts and tribunals, such as the ICTR, face a lot of criticism. It is hard to appease the entire world. But the criticisms, they're quite interesting.
One of the major criticisms of the ICJ is that it hears too few cases every year. Some years there are no cases at all, but most years there are about 1 to 4 new cases. People might view this as a bad thing, but it may actually help to normalize international law by establishing few rulings for law to be based off. The ICJ does a good job of establishing normative laws and rights that belong to states, but ruling on more specific matters could affect this important aspect of the court. Another major criticism of the ICJ is that its cases take too long. Cases often take many years and can remain unresolved for quite a long period of time. While many critics would like to see quicker rulings from the court, few cases actually require immediate rulings. More cases establish and protect basic laws and rights, which makes the long process acceptable. Critics also point to over-politicization of the court as another problem of the ICJ. Judges could let their political interests and the political interests of the state they represent get in the way of doing their job properly. Yet another complaint is that few states submit to the ICJ's compulsory jurisdiction. Jurisdiction is often the main question, and respondent states have the opportunity to officially challenge the ICJ's jurisdiction. Article 36 of the ICJ statute outlines 4 ways courts get jurisdiction. International organizations. NATO, the EU, the African Union, and many other international organizations have significant impact on international practices, but they can neither file a claim nor have a claim filed against them before the ICJ. If the ICJ wants to be effective in norm setting, this is a significant problem. In addition to international organizations, private enterprises and individuals also cannot have their cases taken to the ICJ. Many critics of the ICJ point to the problems lesser developed countries face in accessing the court. In response to this, in 1989, the UN Secretary General set up a trust fund to help these poorer countries cover expenses incurred in connection with an ICJ case. Unfortunately, this trust fund has been very unsuccessful so far.
Article 38 of the ICJ statute explains how law is applied. In it, there are 3 distinct characteristics of how this should be done. They are international conventions, whether general or particular, establishing rules expressly recognized by the consenting states. International customs, as evidence of a general practice accepted as law. And finally, the general principles of law recognized by civilized nations. To sum it all up, every case must prove that there has been a disturbance in the international order. That being said, the United States cannot sue Mexico for allowing Mexicans to jump over the border and come into America. However, if the United States wanted to link the illegal immigration problem to an international drug trafficking issue, they may be able to have their case heard. Also, the international community must feel an actual injustice was committed. Otherwise, you would have states suing each other left and right for no reason except for things that can probably link to ancient hatred. However, there are major issues with the ICJ's strength and role in the international community. A lot of states don't listen to what they need to do as set by the court. Remember, the United States did not pay reparations to Nicaragua, and nothing happened to them as a result. The International Court of Justice is probably one of the more intricate parts of international law. In its 67 years of existence, the ICJ has been through a lot. Despite its many criticisms, it is still highly regarded in the international community. All in all, the ICJ has shown mostly positive aspects to the world. With the exception of not having a strong jurisdiction, the court is the international judiciary medium of the world. This was the ICJ.